the Outspoken Narrative. Today we have with us Justice K.T. Shankaran sir. He will be taking a webinar on the topic, an overview of civil code practices. Without further ado, I hand it over to you, sir. So you can start.
Good evening, all of you. First of all, I thank Ms. Niranjana Nair for giving me an opportunity to interact with the young friends. Today, our topic is an overview of civil code practice. So first of all, I suppose that all of you are law students, right? All of you are law students.
Sir, everyone is on mute, so they can't speak. They can only put on chat.
Ask Niranjana whether all are law students.
No, sir. They are not law students, but few are law students. Many advocates are there. And like a lot of people, those who are connected with legal field. So everyone is there.
Okay.
We have a very mixed audience today. We have a lot of advocates. We have, as Venkateshwar said, we have students, advocates, we have professors, we have everyone related to the law field.
So my doubt is this: if it is students, it is a type is different. Type of lecture would be different. If it is a young lawyer, it is different. If it is an experienced lawyer, it is different. All difference will be there.
Yes, sir.
This is a mixed audience. So please bear with me if I go to the rudiments of it, because we have to cater to the needs of the law students first. And how many law students are there, Niranjana?
Sir, we have a majority of law students as of now. So we had like 200 registrations, more than 200 actually. So
all of them have joined.
197 have joined today.
Can you ask them, out of 197, how many of them would like to join the bar?
So you all heard sir's question. Please put it on the chat box so that we know. I can tell him.
Now, anyhow, let us take it that at least a sizable number of you would like to join the bar.
Yes, sir. Let's take it like that.
Let us take it there. So, first of all, I would say that any other profession better than any other profession which a law student can think of, our profession of law as an advocate is better going by any standard. Only thing is that if you join an MNC, you may get to start with sometimes 35,000, 1 lakh or even 1.5 lakhs. But after a few years, you will ask a question to yourself, quote, "Who am I?" This question you will ask to yourself, most of you, then you will have no answer. Same thing happened in my house. My son is a chartered accountant. He joined a big company. He was drawing more than 1 lakh rupees to start with. Went to Bangalore. I told him, all right, it is your choice. But after a few years, you will ask a question to yourself, who am I? Then you return and practice yourself. Within 3-4 years, he asked that question to himself, came back to Ernakulam and started afresh in a firm of chartered accountants. And he has started it. I have seen several law students joining the bar again. And I had an experience in the Nuwals that at the time of recession, the MNCs had cut down the salaries to a considerable extent, and therefore it was not lucrative for the law students to join the MNCs. I invited them to the bar, and many of them are fine lawyers now in the Kerala High Court and in the subordinate courts. Fine lawyers, earning much also. So far as earning is concerned, there are lawyers, dear friends, there are lawyers who get more than what Shah Rukh Khan gets a day or a month. There are lawyers who do not get, say, even 10,000 rupees a month. Depends on your skill, your luck, your hard work, and so many other factors. But I have not seen any young man losing the field if he is hardworking, dedicated to the profession, and well-versed in the profession. He will rise, no doubt about it. And in this profession, many think that young lawyers have no place, only seniors will hold the field. That is not correct. I am saying from experience, age is not a bar at all. So far as I shifted after 3 years of practice in the trial court to shifted to the high court, I was a very young man at that time. And within 2 or 3 years, I was working under a senior, and I started arguing cases within 6 months. And I got the help of all the senior judges. And maximum accommodation was being given to young lawyers at that time and even now, provided you study your brief, present it well, behave properly to the court and to the opponent, and do justice to your case. Then it is not a matter whether you are 20, 30 years old or 60 years old or 70 years old. You will find a place in the profession, no doubt about it. I am saying this from experience. So going by any standard, I will say the lawyer's profession is the best profession. Now we come to, see Niranjana, what is the time, maximum time I can take? Now it is 7 minutes to 5. Up to what time? You decide.
So what we have informed them is till 6:30.
6:30.
I assume it's okay if it extends.
So I will see that my lecture will be over by 6:30.
It's okay. Fine, sir. If it extends, I'm assuming that everyone will be okay with it. Since we are all gaining knowledge from you, it's very difficult to get your time. So.
Okay. So first of all, if you are a lawyer, you are governed by the Advocates Act. The Advocates Act, under the Advocates Act, provision is made for Bar Council of India and the Bar Council of different states. Representatives will be elected from among the members of the bar, and they will have their own rules of working, and it will be regulated. That is a supreme body. Bar Council of India is the supreme body so far as lawyers is concerned. And one of the functions of the Bar Council of India under Section 7 of the Advocates Act is to lay down the standards of professional conduct and etiquette for advocates. And they have got disciplinary power. The state bar councils also have disciplinary power. They can suspend your sentence. They can remove you from the roles of the bar council, etc. And under Section 16(1), it is provided that there shall be 2 classes of advocates, namely senior advocates and other advocates. Senior advocateship is conferred either by the Supreme Court or the respective high courts of persons having required standing at the bar, and if they feel that they are good at the profession. And that will be conferred, and they have got a different set of rules. They cannot directly contact with a party. They cannot communicate with the party, only through another lawyer. They can have the briefs, have the instructions, etc. And that is a different class of lawyers. That is why you will see senior advocate. Senior advocate is not by age, but by conferment. Section 29 of the Advocates Act. See, this is the most important thing for the advocates. How you should be proud of. Advocates to be the only recognized class of persons entitled to practice law, subject to the provisions of this Act and in the rules made thereunder, there shall, as from the appointed day, be only one class of persons entitled to practice the profession of law, namely advocates. What more is required for a youngster like you? You are one among the privileged class to practice law in any court in India. Any court in India, including Supreme Court, however, with certain restrictions. Section 30 provides right of advocates to practice. Subject to the provisions of this Act, every advocate whose name is entered in the state roll shall be entitled as of right to practice throughout the territories to which this Act extends. One, in all courts, including Supreme Court, subject, of course, to the restrictions. Two, before any tribunal or person legally authorized to take evidence. And three, before any authority or person before whom such advocate is by or under any law for the time being in force entitled to practice. Though the Advocates Act is pretty old, Chapter 4 containing Section 30 was notified only on 15th June 2011 on account of the persistent demand from the bar that the advocate should be permitted to practice as of right in any court or tribunal. Now it has become a reality. Therefore, you are entitled to practice anywhere in India, subject, of course, to the restrictions regarding registration. Now, there are certain duties also. Bar Council of India rules, particularly part 6, thereof, provides for many things. You are a privileged class, and rules provide specifically that you cannot behave in a manner in a particular situation where an ordinary citizen may behave like in a particular manner. That particular manner, that method cannot be adopted by a lawyer. So if two persons have a quarrel, they abuse each other, both are guilty. If one side is an advocate, he cannot react in the manner in which an ordinary person may react. He cannot. That is, the society expects of certain standard from the lawyers inside and outside court. And there are ever so many Supreme Court decisions that the lawyers are not entitled to strike and desist from doing work, cannot shout in court, cannot use intemperate language, etc., etc. If you are interested, I will give the citation, just citation. Please take down 1999 1 SEC 37 MP Singh versus Messrs. Jack's Aviation Private Limited. That was a resolution passed by the Delhi Bar Association to boycott a particular jet. That matter was considered by the Supreme Court and it was held that it is illegal. Then another 1996 Criminal Law Journal 2755 State of Andhra Pradesh versus Anjaya Advocate. An advocate addressed an argument in a raised tone and questioned the authority of the court. Bar Association called a boycott court, held that the boycott court cannot be resorted to by advocates. Contempt action was taken against the advocates. You may see paragraph 9, 24 and 26, particularly para 9, where para 9, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, etc. All the earlier decisions of the Supreme Court on the point were discussed in detail by the Supreme Court. 17, 19, 22 last, etc. Next is AER 2003 Supreme Court 739. which is a constitution bench decision consisting of 5 judges. Ex-Captain Harish Uppal versus Union of India and another. Advocates have no right to go on strike or call a boycott call. Next is 2013, Volume 14 SEC. 2013, Volume 14 SEC 127. Arun Kumar Yadav versus State of UP. And one more, AER 2001 Supreme Court 457. 3 judges, D.P. Chadda versus Triyogi Narayan Mishra. Counsel for the party creating a situation resulting into the recording of false and fabricated compromise in the court. He was instrumental for the fraud and he was imposed a punishment of 5 years by the State Bar Council, which was raised to 10 years by the Bar Council of India and later reduced to 5 years, restored to 5 years by the Supreme Court. Considering his advanced age, so court take it very seriously, your conduct. So you cannot be a party to a fraud. So an advocate is an officer of the court. He is a respectable member of the bar. He is a respectable member of the judicial system. And he must get that respect. He must give that respect. So though we do not find in recent days so much of standard in the profession, we all lament about the deterioration in standard that is there in every profession. And our profession is also not an exception to that. And there is a trend. I may say, among the young lawyers, there is a trend to straight away start practice in the Supreme Court and get internship under a Supreme Court judge, then practice there and say, you do not know what is a practice in the trial court, what is a practice in the district court, what is a practice in the high court, nothing. And what is the latest field, transgender, environment was the field earlier and then global warming, this and that. So you need only study one book and the 11 provisions of the constitution, that is enough. Part 3 of the constitution and some other provisions and article 32, that alone is enough. And then you will become a very big man all of a sudden. And the Supreme Court has frowned upon the same recently and said that we are thinking of providing a guideline that a advocate before coming to the Supreme Court has to practice in the subordinate courts compulsory. I am personally of opinion that it is required. Now take a case. A person from Kerala or Karnataka goes to directly to the Supreme Court. He comes back home and his neighbor meets him as a Supreme Court lawyer. All right, sir, my neighbor has encroached upon a piece of land belonging to me. What shall I do? So what will be your answer? You do not know the civil law. You do not know civil procedure code. You do not know what are the rights of parties, what to do, where to file the court, what is the fee to be paid, what should be done in court. You do not know because you have started practice in the Supreme Court. Then what will be your answer? No. Let me meet a local lawyer. I know only human rights and this and that. Would that answer satisfy your neighbor? Your neighbor, though illiterate, will say that this man does not know, or this boy or girl does not know anything. So that you must know the rudiments of law, practice, and the real thrill in practice lies in the practice before the subordinate courts. Examination of parties and cross-examination. Law you can learn by reading. Cross-examination is an art which is inborn. 1, 2, you can develop to a great extent by constant practice and hard work. It is an art and you will be thrilled if you become a good cross-examiner. And there are books also, theoretical side also, you can learn how to cross-examine, etc., etc., where to stop. Now, what is a cross-examination? Subordinate courts made by youngsters. I have seen. Ask left and right all sorts of scandalous questions. Hurt him, ridicule him, shout your voice. That is not cross examination. Not at all. I have seen stalwarts cross examining. They will never raise their voice. They will never interrupt the witness. They will say, you answer whatever it is. And I have seen a lawyer, along with him, I have appeared for another party. He will say, you answer anything you want. Take your own time. The moment the answer comes, the next question comes. And I have seen witnesses fainting. And I have seen witnesses asking, quitting the witness box, saying that I am thirsty, I want water. That is the fulfillment of a lawyer as a cross-examiner. There lies his success. So you must be a skilled person. You will never get in any office. You will be just like any furniture. What is it? Who are you? Are you? Have you got any identity? No, no identity. I am in so-and-so office, big office. What else? Nothing. So that have your practice in the subordinate courts in your local place, in your village. You will be a respectable person. Village, town, nearby town. There will be courts. You practice there. And if you want, you may shift to the High Court and even may go to Supreme Court. Do you know K.K. Venugopal, who is the Solicitor General of India? His father was a lawyer, N.K. Nambiar, who was practicing in Mangalore, Karnataka. And he argued A.K. Gopalan's case, first case, constitutional case before the Supreme Court. He was in the trial court, in the Mangalore court, and then came to Madras. And at that time, he had gone to Supreme Court and argued A.K. Gopalan versus Union of India. And at that time, the Supreme Court judges where say he is not a senior lawyer, he is a man who is coming from the south. They did not take him so seriously. Then the Attorney General said, your lordship will be hearing an eminent jurist. I do not repeat the words, I do not know exact words. The meaning is this. An eminent person and probably the first constitutional law, constitutional case in the Supreme Court. And you are going to hear it. Don't miss it. And then the arguments went on. And they had ultimately to bow their heads before Justice, before Mr. M.K. Nambiar, who is the father of Sri K.K. Venugopal. And Sri Venugopal also practiced in the trial court and then came to Madras, then went to Supreme Court like that. So there is enough room. There is enough room in the top of the ladder. Rush is below. Below there is heavy rush. You have no place. Forget the social distance. So crowded. But when you climb upstairs, everything is super. So practice. Became a good practitioner. And in the practice in the subordinate courts became glorified when Birla case came. Birla family's case, a will. At that time, it was Calcutta High Court, Calcutta subordinate court. And then the attention of the youngsters, attention of all lawyers were in the subordinate courts when that Birla's case was being argued. There also a trial court lawyer was engaged, not a Supreme Court lawyer. So don't think that practice in the Supreme Court alone is glorified and the practice in the subordinate courts is bad. No, it is the other way about. Go to Supreme Court later if you want, but be skillful and be a very good lawyer, proficient lawyer, learned lawyer, respectable lawyer. Then you shift to the Supreme Court. No harm. And dear friends, now our subject is civil court practice. What is civil court? What are the civil courts? Slight difference will be there from state to state. What is hierarchy of courts? So far as our state, Kerala state is concerned, I will say, then I will say in the other states also. Say the lowest grade is Munsif or Munsif Magistrate sometimes. And he is doing the functions of Munsif, civil cases, and a few days criminal also. So, Munsif is the lowest grade. Then the next appellate court is the subordinate judges court. Then goes the district court. then the High Court, then the Supreme Court. In other states, in the North Indian states, it is junior division officer, senior division officer, civil judge, then district judge, High Court judge, Supreme Court. Same thing, only name differs. And where case is to be filed. So you have got a case. Your neighbor has encroached upon your land, or your neighbor is discharging foul water to your compound, or he is threatening to cut a tree, valuable tree, from your compound, or he is about to encroach upon your rights and land, river, pond, or any other water course. What to do? Where do you go? Do you go to police? Police you may go, but you will get a final conclusive remedy? No. Even if a criminal case is registered, there are some activities of people may amount to criminal activity, may amount to civil activity also. Civil cause of action also. But criminal activity, so for example, trespass, it is an offense under the IPC and it is a civil wrong under the and a case can be filed before the civil court. And if the matter comes before the criminal court, maxima, he will be punished. What else? Nothing. Whereas if you go to civil court, you want injunction, you want declaration of title, you want recovery of possession if he has already trespassed, you want to get back possession, you want recovery of possession, you want mandatory injunction if the acts of possession are sporadic, not a complete dispossession. Or if there is a license, you want to get back it. See, mandatory injunction. Or your compound wall is pulled down, you want to have it reconstructed at the expense of the opposite party, mandatory injunction. And specific performance, you have agreed to purchase a land, that vendor is not prepared to sell it to you. What to do? Go to the civil court. File a suit for specific performance of contract, which is the act that governs specific relief. Even otherwise, the reliefs which I said earlier, you will find a place in the Specific Relief Act. So you have got one act, Specific Relief Act. Property laws. Where do you get? It is in the Transfer of Property Act. And the procedure, you will get in the Code of Civil Procedure. Master it. And you have to file a suit. That is what is called suit. So I sent the example, your neighbor trespassed upon your land or threatening to trespass. You want some action before the civil court. Otherwise, he will pull down the compound wall, pull down the buildings, cut down the trees, and encroach upon the property and oust you, dispossess you. So immediately rush to the civil court, which is the court. Court of the lowest grade. Where do you get that? Section 15 of the CPC. Code of Civil Procedure 19.8. 15 says that every case shall be filed in the court of the lowest grade competent to try it. You cannot go straight away. There are some people, Philip Stubbs, if there is a complaint against a man, go directly to the Director General of Police. Would he take action? No. He will send it to the IG. He will send it to the DSP. DSP will send it to the Circle Inspector. Circle Inspector will send to the sub-inspector. That is the same procedure, only thing some delay. So you cannot go filing a civil suit before the Munshi's court. You cannot go to the Supreme Court and file it there. You can't. So that court has got every power to decide the case finally. Finally. Complete and final adjudication of all the disputes involved in the case and arising between the parties will be decided by the civil court. And what will happen if a decision is rendered by the civil court? It is forever. Suppose you trespassed upon my property. I file a civil suit before the civil court for declaration of my title and recovery of possession. A decree is passed in my favor. It is executed and you are dispossessed by the officer of the court and possession is given to me and that has become final, whether appeal filed or not, everything has become final. What is the effect of that judgment? that judgment will be final and conclusive as between the parties with respect to the subject matter forever. Where do you get it? Section 11 of the Code of Civil Procedure, res judicata. Res judicata is a big section. No court shall try any suit or issue in which the matter which has been directly and substantially in issue has been directly and substantially in issue in a formal suit between the same parties or parties under whom they claim litigating under the same title in a court which is competent to try the subsequent suit and has been heard and finally decided by a court. Then 8 explanations are there. That itself take, if I want to lecture it, that takes at least 10 to 15 hours. Not less than that. So, final and conclusive, such a verdict, even a high court cannot give. High court writ petitions come, it will be disposed of with some observations, some directions, this and that. Supreme Court also, it is not forever. Whereas a civil court, it is forever. A final and conclusive decision. Power is there. Vast powers are there for the civil court. Civil court can, and then what are the, what is the procedure? Procedure is contained in the Code of Civil Procedure. How to file a suit? I said that Section 15, Court of the Lowest Grade. And then what are the other things to be taken? Suppose you have borrowed money from me and you have executed a promissory note in my favor on 1/1/2015. You are not returning the money, repaying the money to me. What is my right? I can file a suit before the civil court. Within what time period of limitation is there? That period is provided where? In the Limitation Act. So you have to study the Limitation Act also. Limitation Act contains 31 sections and 137 articles. And it is based on these articles. There are 3 columns in each, with respect to each article. Name of the description of the suit, period of limitation, and the period from which the time begins to run. With respect to these aspects, the final date for filing a suit will be determined and it can be filed on that day, not later. And there is power to condone Section 5, not with respect to suits, but only with respect to appeals and applications. Suit, if that is the last date, 1/1/2015, you borrowed money from me, executed a promissory note. My last date to file the suit is 1/1/2018. If I file it on 2nd January, it is barred by limitation. I can't have the remedy through civil court. Last date is there. So the lawyer has to know the limitation. Lawyer has to know what right is there, what act is applicable, has to know. He has to present the plaint. One more thing, he has to pay the court fee. Court fee is regulated by state acts. Court fees and suit valuation act. Different rates are provided. Different states, different tariffs. So if you file a suit for 10 lakhs, realization of 10 lakhs, there is a schedule which provides for this person up to 15,000, then next 35,000, this much, thereafter this much, after 10 million, this much, and it goes up and down. Whereas our Kerala Act was one tariff after 15,000. Yeah, whatever amount it is, it was 10%. But Bombay, we adopted later the Bombay and other high courts, other states court fees act. And now it goes from low to up, then comes down. And after 10 million, it is 1% court fee. That court fee has to be paid. Without court fee, you cannot file. For petitions also, court fee is there. Different states. It's 100 rupees here. Court fee is there. But it is called ad valorem court fee, depending on the valuation of the suit. Court fee is there. That court fee should be paid in the form of court fee stamp. So the lawyer must know What is the right of the party? What is the remedy? Which act applies? You must know the procedure. You must know the limitation. You must know the court fee. And you must know all that is required. Civil rules of practice. If you are in the High Court rules, High Court Act. Various other acts. If there are special statutes like rent control laws in different states, you must know that. There are special statutes where the procedure is different, you must know that. And if there is a special statute, for example, Delhi Police Establishments Act, where a policeman beats you, unnecessary, policeman beats you, affects your rights, you have to file a suit for compensation against that erring policeman. You have to file it within 6 months. Whereas a compensation suit in similar circumstances under the Limitation Act, the period is 1 year, which will apply. The state act will apply. Why? Because it is a special statute. Where do you get it? In section 29(2) of the Limitation Act, which says that where any special or local law provides for a period of limitation, which is different from the schedule in the Limitation Act, then sections 4 to 24 will apply to the extent to which, only to the extent to which, they are not specifically excluded by such special or local law. These are all complicated. Complicated, you have to study it, study, study, study. Read. Understand the developments in law of the various decisions of the Supreme Court and various high courts, and then apply. So civil court practice is not as easy as in the criminal court practice. That is why youngsters are more attracted to the criminal court practice. There, if you have IPC, CRPC and Evidence Act, and if it is a special statute, that special statute alone, that is enough. Whereas for civil court, that is not enough. There are hundreds, thousands of laws, whichever is applicable. See, if I want to conduct a case under a special statute which came into force only recently, it is not an answer that during LLB I did not study that. I have to study it now. It takes no time to study it. Citizenship Amendment Act came. When a case comes, you have to read it, understand it. Various laws will come. New gen laws are there. So you have to study it every. See, constant study is the that makes you alert, sharp. And you will have a long life if you are a lawyer. Hard work and practice, you will live like anything. You will never get ill. A lawyer never, usually never gets laid up. Because that will affect his practice, therefore you will go. Whereas if you are having a government job, you will take leave. For everything, leave. That is not so. So you will be alert. You are really energetic and you will have pleasure also in doing the work. It is you are the master of your own. There is no master above you. You decide how to practice. You decide how to conduct yourself. And you decide what is your future. What more is required? To start with, there will be some struggle. Now, come back. CPC, CRPC, Transfer of Property Act, specifically Fact, Contract Act, Evidence Act, Limitation Act, Special Statute, rules under the various special statutes, Rent Control Laws, PWDV Act, Prevention of Atrocities Against Women, POCSO Act. So many acts are there, all come. Constitution of Courts, Supreme Courts, High Courts. And so far as practicing in the subordinate courts, you must know the constitution that also comes in. The hierarchy of courts, professional ethics, all those things you must understand. And then how a case is filed. And then how to conduct yourself in court. I'll come back to CPC again as to the filing of the case, etc. Before doing it, I'll say your behavior in court. You must be a decent man. Respect the elders. Respect the court. Behave properly. Argue calmly. Well composed. Never lose your temper. Put forward your case. Understand the opponent. Understand the court. And realize what questions will be put by the judge at what point of time and how to answer it. Whenever any question is put, there must be an answer. How to do it? You study from elders. We were all sitting in court till 4:35, hearing the arguments of others. But now that practice has vanished. Whenever your case is over by 12 o'clock, you will leave the court. Don't leave. Sit there, hear the arguments of top seniors, and you will learn a lot which you otherwise will not learn. That was our seniors used to insist. Even if they go early, your juniors must remain in court and hear the arguments of other seniors. That you have to practice for initial years, then you will have your own method in arguing and you will earn fame. Good lawyers are the respect for elders, respect to court, respect to the opposite side, presentation of the case in a respectful manner, good behavior, stature of a lawyer. You shall not tell a lie in court. You are not expected to tell a lie. See, you present the party's case. You are not there to manipulate. You are not a crook. You are not a fraud. And then now, what is a case? I said the example. You have to get money from your friend. Your friend is not paying back the amount which you had given, 1 lakh. He is not giving it back. You are in dire need of money. You have to file a suit. Where? The lowest court, having competence. Where do you get it? It is in the respective civil courts act of the state. The jurisdiction of the court is defined there. So that is called pecuniary jurisdiction. So you must know which court will have pecuniary jurisdiction. So you have to file, going by section 15, the lowest court and capable of having jurisdiction to entertain it. You have to file it there. Then you have to pay the court fee, I said. Then territorial jurisdiction. Jurisdiction, pecuniary jurisdiction, territorial jurisdiction, and jurisdiction over the subject matter. These are the three aspects of jurisdiction. So what is a territorial jurisdiction? You have got a property. And the case is with respect to the property, suit for specific performance or suit for declaration of title and recovery of possession, whatever it is with respect to immovable property. So where to file it? It is to be filed in the court within whose jurisdiction the property lies. There are some cases where the cause of action has arisen, where a transaction took place. There are some cases where the parties reside. All these things are seen from sections 16 to 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Jurisdiction. So territorial jurisdiction must be there. Then third aspect is jurisdiction over the subject matter. That is very difficult. Usually there is no difficulty, but there are some cases where it may, you will taste the difficulty. Where do you get it? Section 9. It gives section 9 of the Code of Civil Procedure. I will read for you, barring the exceptions. Then it will take time. Section 9. Suits. Courts to try all suits unless barred. Court must have territorial jurisdiction, must have pecuniary jurisdiction, and jurisdiction over the subject matter. There is a dispute between the husband and wife, marital dispute. And the husband or wife, as the case may be, wants to get a divorce. Where to file it? Only the family court has jurisdiction. After the promulgation, after the enactment of the Family Courts Act, exclusive jurisdiction is conferred on the family court. Till then it was district court, now it is family court. Therefore, you cannot file it before the district court, you cannot file it in the Munsis court, junior division officer or senior division officer, civil judge, all those courts have no jurisdiction at all. And it is only the family court which is having jurisdiction over the subject matter. And section 9 of the CPC says that the court shall, subject to the provisions herein contained, have jurisdiction to try all suits of a civil nature, excepting suits of which their cognizance is either expressly or impliedly barred. Express bar, there is no difficulty. There are some special statutes which say that in respect of matters covered by this statute, the civil court will have no jurisdiction. Only the particular tribunal which is constituted under that act will have jurisdiction. Then there is no difficulty. Only that court has jurisdiction. That tribunal has jurisdiction. Not the civil court. And either expressly or impliedly barred. What is implied bar? Though there is no express bar, but if it is contained, new rights are created for the first time under a special statute and a new remedy is provided and the new law is self-contained, then the courts will say that it is a self-contained statute and the civil court's jurisdiction is impliedly barred. That is a field which is very vast. Just I am giving an introduction, and it will take section 9 itself will take hours and hours to have a lecture. I will give two or three instances. See, there was a temple in Madras, Tamil Nadu. Big. There are 24 or 25 shrines within that compound. There arose disputes among the Jir families. Jirs, they are the persons, Archakas, the persons who are trustees. There arose a dispute among the Jirs. Who has to receive the Tulasi Tirtha first in the row? That was the dispute. It may appear to us to be flimsy. Flimsy. That was the dispute which went up to, and it was decided in AER 1961 Supreme Court. You may take down, I will give three examples. There are thousands and thousands of cases on Section 9. I will give three cases. AER 1961 Supreme Court 1720. See, that is Sri Rangaramanuja Jr. versus Sinna Ramanuja Jr. versus Rangaramanuja Jr. Alias Vanamamalai Jr. This, that, and all those things. Either Rangaramanuja Jr. versus Sinna Ramanuja Jr. or Sinna Ramanuja Jr. versus Rangaramanuja Jr. That is in 1961 Supreme Court 1720, worth reading. To understand Section 9. That, see, complicated facts. You will get bored initially, but when you go inside, you will understand. Then, Supreme Court said that it is purely a religious matter, unconnected with any civil right. Therefore, the civil court will have no jurisdiction. Another case, church case, Malangara church case. It is in thousands and thousands of cases in Kerala over the years, more than half a century, old case. And finally, it was decided by the Supreme Court in AER 1995, Supreme Court 2001, more and more Basilio's case. Don't try to read the whole thing, facts. You will get not only bored, you will faint. See the principles there. Even the church people do not know how to understand all those things. So many events over the years. The principle under Section 9 is set. There, a Christian was excommunicated from the church. Whether the civil court will have jurisdiction or whether his remedy lies in the church was the question. And it was argued on behalf of the church that only church court will have jurisdiction, civil court will have no jurisdiction. This is purely a religious matter. And therefore, the suit before the civil court does not lie. And the Supreme Court said, no. It affects the civil rights of parties and therefore the civil court will have jurisdiction. That is a finding. So, another case. Third case, I will say that is Muslims. Kutuba, in every Jummah mosque, on Friday there will be a congregation and there will be Jummah prayer. And in the Jummah prayer, there will be Kutuba. There are several ingredients of Jummah prayer, that is Hamd, Salat, wasiyat and dua. This is called wasiyat. Wasiyat is the third part or fourth part where the khutbah will be there. It is an advice to the congregation according to one sect, whereas a prayer in, which according to the other another sect. Whatever it is, one sect, Sunnis say that it should be in Arabic and Arabic only, whereas the Mujahids say that it can be the local language which is known to the congregation. That was the dispute. And in various parts of Kerala, there were hundreds of cases, and finally it was settled by the High Court. That is the only and one only case in India about that case. That is 2000 volume 2 KLT. 2000 volume 2 KLT 216. Kerala Law Times. There it was settled that this is a civil right. Khutbah. Muhammad versus Muhyiddin Haji. Muhammad versus Muhyiddin Haji. It is an AER also. AER 2000 Kerala 329. Just I am giving an introduction to section 9 so that is a civil court's jurisdiction. You have seen the jurisdiction, where to file it, court fee, this court fees act you have to study, what court fee is to be paid, etc. Limitation act you have to study, within what time it is to be filed, what are the principles of limitation act, etc. You have to study. Then you will present a paper in court, plaintiff. If you file the suit, you are the plaintiff. Your opponent is the defendant. What is a plaintiff? The paper which is presented before the court, it is called a plaint. Where do you get it? In section 26 and order 7 rule 1. CPC Civil Procedure Code, I am saying for law students, contained in two parts. Sections are there, then orders and rules are. Sections enacted by the parliament, orders and rules also by the parliament, but orders and rules can be amended by the state, respective states, by the rule committee. Rule committee, there is a rule committee under the High Court, sections 121 to 125 of the Civil Code, CPC provides for it. And there will be three senior judges, two advocates, and a secretary. For the rule committee, the rule committee will make suggestions to the amendment of rules, orders and rules, and that will be considered by the full court of the High Court, and recommendations will be made. It will be sent to the government. If the government notifies it, and that becomes the rule in that particular state. So from state to state, that varies. Parliament enacts, but the state can modify that particular. So in a particular say order or rule, there will be something, for example, order 34 in our state, that is suit relating to mortgages. In our state, it was composite decree, whereas the central statute, it is preliminary decree as well as final decree. Now that is changed here also because of the amendment of CPC. So you are presenting a plaint. Plaint shall contain the names and address of the parties, address for service, what is your grievance, what is your right, what is the remedy you are asking for, what is the jurisdiction of the court, what is the valuation, what is the court fee, what is the schedule of property. All these things will be stated and presented before the court in the prescribed manner as per the civil rules of practice of that particular state. All those things should be contained and it will be in a perfect. That is presented. There you will get what are to be, that is called pleadings. I'll come to pleadings later. You present the plaint and it is called suit. It will be numbered and then see X files a suit against Y. X is the plaintiff, Y is the defendant. The defendant does not know. He must know it. He must have an opportunity to argue his case. To present his case. X says that Y borrowed money from him and executed a promissory note. Y has to be given an opportunity of being heard. How? Notice should go. It is called summons. service of summons. You will get an order 5 and summons will be sent to the defendant. Defendant has got an opportunity to appear and then file his paper, that is what is called written statement. That you will get in order 8 of the CPC. Order 8, written statement. There are rules. And you file the written statement. You say that you had not borrowed money from the plaintiff X. Y says that no, I have not borrowed money. I am not indebted to X. So what will happen to the court? In the court. So this is the area of dispute. X, the plaintiff says that Y has had borrowed money from me, X says. Y says, I have never borrowed money from Y. X. What is that the court has to decide? Whether X had paid that money to Y. Whether Y had executed the promissory note. What are the reliefs grantable to the plaintiff? Whether the suit is maintainable, if that question of maintainability is challenged. These are all the matters which are to be decided by the court. That is what is called issues. Settlement of issues. See, based on the pleadings, the court will settle issues. You will get in order 14. Order 14. Settlement of issues and determination of suit on issues of law, etc., etc. So issues are to be settled and decision will be rendered on those issues. Then I said about pleadings. Order 4, Rule 1 says, what is pleading? Pleading means plain or written statement. What are the rules with respect to pleadings? There are rules with respect to pleadings. I'll just give you an indication. You have to see the provisions of Order 1 of the Code of Civil Procedure. Who are all the parties? Who can be the parties? Who should be the parties to the suit? Order 2, frame of suit. How the suit should be framed. I am not going to the details because you will get bored, law students. You have to read yourself and understand it. Order 4, institutional suit. That is by presentation of claim. Then Order 6, pleadings generally. Order 7, plaint. What are the documents to accompany the plaint? What are the things to be done along with the plaint? What the plaintiff should do, etc. All those things are stated there. Then Order 8, what the defendant has to file in court. His paper, what it should contain. What are the defenses available? What is counterclaim? What is set off? All those things you will get in Order 8. And then, as I said, under Order 14, the issues will be settled. Then the court will decide the issue. 1 hour is over. I said 6:30 was is the time, is it not? Niranjana? Yes. So I'll close it by 6:30. So there will be a return statement. And all those things, issues will be recited, production of documents is there, and then trial. That is the most important part of the case. Parties will be examined. There, what are the rules? The rules in the Evidence Act will apply. Examination in chief, examination cross, etc., etc. Cross-examination, re-examination. That is the there lies the real life of civil litigation. Trial. And after the trial, there will be arguments, hearing, and there will be judgment. Judgment and decree will be passed by the court. What is judgment is defined. What is decree is defined in section 2. The court will pass a judgment and decree. And during the process of the suit, there may arise necessity for filing interlocutory applications. What are those interlocutory applications? Several. So I am filing a suit against you, saying that you have threatened to trespass upon my property. Your threat is imminent. I have filed the suit against you for granting a perpetual injunction against you, restraining you from trespassing upon my property. But for the time being, what should be done? There must be an interim order. Interim order, where do you get? You can have specifically, if act provides for interim injunction, temporary injunction. And where do you get in the CPC? Order 39. There are the rules. Order 39 of the CPC provides for all these rules. You have to comply with all those things. And then you can say, filing immediately, filing today, file. Today itself, you may get an ex parte interim order restraining the defendant from cutting the trees, pending decision of that application. Then you will get notice, summons. Then you will appear and you can put forward your arguments. Your arguments will be heard and the court will take a final decision with respect to that interlocutory application, temporary injunction, whether it should be granted or not. That will be decided. And that will be till the disposal of the case. So that peace, status quo, will have to be maintained till the disposal of the suit. That is what is aimed at. Then there are commissions. See, I file a suit against you. You are altering the nature of the property. You are about to cut down valuable trees. You are about to pull down my compound wall. You are about to damage my property in a considerable way. I complain that and I file a suit against you for perpetual injunction restraining you from interfering with my rights, with all the rights aforesaid, and injuncting you from doing it. But the suit final disposal, it may take 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, depending on the nature of the work in the court, pressure of work in the court, depending on the state to state, etc. Till then, what will happen? Temporary injunction. What is a temporary injunction? What was the state on the date of filing the suit? Nobody knows. Plaintiff will say that this was in existence at the time when the suit was filed. Defendant will say, no, that was destroyed earlier, several years ago in flood. So what is the state of affairs with respect to the property? It has to be, the court has to be apprised of it. How to do it? Court can appoint a court commissioner. Where do you get it? Under Order 26 of the Code of Civil Procedure. So the commissioner can visit the property, file a report, file a sketch, file a plan, measure the property if necessary, and identify the property, and all these things can be done. So that what was the status quo as on the date of suit will be clear to the court, and the court can rely upon the same and make the decision accordingly at the time of final disposal of the case. Sometimes it has gone. Hello, can you hear me? Niranjana, something happened here. Yes, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, you can. We can hear you.
Something happened in the computer in the meanwhile. Oh. Yes. So, I said about the commission. See, I filed a suit against you for recovery of money. How to recover it? Decree is passed in my favor. But by that time, you transfer your property. You are about to transfer your whole property. So that even if I get a decree, I will not be able to realize it. So that is your plan. I understand it. I approach the court. I can file an application for an attachment of the property. That is, where do you get it? It will be available in Order 38 of the CPC. Interim attachment can be passed, and after hearing both parties, an attachment order will be past, and that attachment will continue till execution is over, and then that will protect. 39, order 39 is the interim injunction, temporary injunction, etc. And then suppose there are large extents of properties. Property is partible among several persons. There are several sharers. There is a joint family. Several sharers, several properties. Some are in possession. Most of them are working either abroad or in different places of India. And only a few, one or two, are taking the income, enjoying it, not sharing the profits, and others are aggrieved by that. And at the same time, since a partition is asked for, and the persons who are in possession are destroying the property, altering the nature of the property, and making the property, diminution of value of the property is caused, etc., etc. Not properly managing, only taking the income, no expenditure is made, being made, no proper cultivation is made, no protection of the property is made. What is your remedy? You can apply to the court to appoint a receiver. Where do you get? Order 40. And then the court ultimately, after all these things, the court will take a decision, court will have a trial, court will pass a judgment. Where do you get? Under order 2. Decree is obtained. Decree is obtained. Then in India it is said, after obtaining the decree, the difficulty of the decree holder starts. What is to be done? Different one or two examples I will give. Decree is to be executed. Where do you get the provisions? That is a major part of CPC. Most difficult part of CPC is execution. Where do you get it? From sections 36 to 74. 36 to 74 and Order 21. Order 21 contains 106 rules. 106 rules. There are various modes of execution. Various modes. See, I obtained a decree against you for realization of money. You are not paying it. Obeying the decree. You are not obeying the decree. But you have got assets. You are not paying. You have got bank accounts. You have got properties. You have got, you are earning. You have got salary. How to realize this amount? I can get an order for arrest and detention of you in civil prison. The court has power to detain a person in civil prison for realization of the decree debt for a specified period that is provided in section 55 to 58. And there are provisions in order 21 also. That is arrest and detention, attachment of property, sale of property, appointment of receiver, etc. And suppose the decree is for recovery of possession of an item of immoral property. How to get it back? See, my property you trespassed upon, you dispossessed me. I have to get it back. I filed a suit. I got a decree for recovery of possession. How to get it back? I have to approach the court in execution, file an execution petition. Court will appoint an officer of the court called Ami. I do not know what is the position in other states. Some officer. He will go to the property and deliver the property to me. And delivery will be recorded and the matter will be closed. Then comes the end. And in the process of delivery, there may sometimes a third party may put forward a claim, and there are different provisions for deciding the claims, etc. And that happens at the time of attachment also, claims can be put forward, then the proceedings will drag on. Then a decision is rendered. Decision is against you. What is your right? You can file an appeal. To which court appeal lies? Then the Civil Courts Act of the particular state provides. What is the jurisdiction of the appellate court, pecuniary jurisdiction of the particular appellate court, district court, subordinate court, etc. That will be decided. By the, with reference to the Civil Courts Act of the particular state, and then appeal lies. And appeal is also decided, there will be a second appeal. Second appeal lies to which court? High Court. Under which provision? Under section 100. appeal lies under which provision? 96 of CVC. 96 says that from every decree of the civil court an appeal lies. That is a protection. If the trial court decides in a manner which is not favorable to you, you have got a right of appeal. The appellate court can correct it. Appellate court can reverse it, modify it, set aside it, and do all that is required. And the appellate court also will have the same powers as provided in section 107 of the Code of Civil Procedure. So these are all, this is a scheme. And review is there. You can approach the same court for reviewing the decision. That is also possible. That is under Order 47 of the CPC. Review power is also. And then revision. The trial court passes an interlocutory order. And you are aggrieved by that order. You can approach the High Court in revision under Section 115 of the Code of Civil Procedure. On what ground? On the ground that the court has failed to exercise the jurisdiction vested in it by law or exceeded its jurisdiction while exercising the jurisdiction, or otherwise it causes prejudice to the parties. And then there are certain restrictions also which were imposed by the 1999 and 2002 amendment. All those things. Revision jurisdiction. Second appeal. Review. It is self-contained. The Code of Civil Procedure, every provision is made clear-cut. You need not search anything else. Study that. It is possible. So, you have to connect all these provisions, sections and orders. Otherwise, reading from section to end is not possible to understand. And many of you, I have realized from the law students over the years, from National University of Advanced Legal Studies, I have realized that people are afraid of the CPC. Are you? Dear friends, CPC is your friend. CPC is your friend. You need not be afraid of it. You approach it in a manner which is conducive to the purpose. Suppose you want to have a relationship, a love with a girl. So you assert yourself. Will the girl come to you? No. So what is it? Say good words, favorable to her, and try to persuade her this and that. Then you can establish a love. In the same manner, CPC you approach in a friendly manner. You study it. You see, it is not 1 or 2 days study. Constantly study it. Approach it in a particular manner. View what is happening in the courts and watch the proceedings in court. Watch the examination of parties. Watch the performance of other lawyers. And over the years, you will slowly understand, study, apply all the provisions in the CPC. It is really a friend of the lawyers. You need not be afraid of CPC. I concentrated on the CPC because most of the students are afraid of CPC. CPC, oh, CPC, nothing. No difficulty at all. And Niranjana, you please give the, you have got the two apps, which are, during Corona time, I could not go to the law college and take classes, and therefore I started YouTube lectures. Now it has crossed over 130 episodes, 82 episodes in CPC, and now it is crossed more than 50 in the Limitation Act. And after completing the Limitation Act, I will come to CPC, complete it.
Sure, sir, I'll share it with everyone.
Are you share?
Yes, sir, I'll share.
So all free, you need not pay a single pie. Only thing is that you can watch, understand, decide. Free, absolutely free. So you share to all the friends.
Yes, I definitely do. Yes.
So it is a friend of you. Now, I did not say about amendment of pleadings. See, while presenting the plain or written statement, you committed a mistake, or your clerk committed a mistake. I file a suit, K.T. Shankaran, son of Shankaran Nair, all right. And instead of it, by cut and paste, my son is Abraham, son of Abraham is written. How to do it? How to correct it? How to correct it? Power is there to amend. Where do you get Order 6, Rule 17? Power to alter or amend at any stage of this. This power was taken away in 99 amendment and it was restored in 2002. And I will say a few words about the CPC amendment. And one of the main provisions which is there, alternative dispute resolution, that is section 83. 83 is very, very important, which is introduced by the 1999 amendment. What happened in 1999? 99 amendment bill was introduced. With that, I will close it because it is not possible to have a detailed study of the various provisions of CPC in this process. I will just introduce the subject and I will also just say about what happened in 99 and 2002 CPC amendment. 99, the bill was introduced in the parliament and it was open for discussion. And various bar councils and bar associations, bar council under the Bar Council of India Act, that is statutory bodies, and bar associations, loose associations, every bar association will be there. All throughout the country had discussion about it, serious discussion. And opinion was sent to the central government, to the Law Commission. And taking into account the pulse of the lawyers and the opinion given by jurists and all those people, the Law Commission also considered it. And then the Parliament, keeping this bill alive, Parliament introduced another bill, CPC Amendment Act 2002. Both these bills were passed by the Parliament on the same day. Same day. And both these amendments act, CPC Amendment Act 1999 and CPC Amendment Act 2002 on the same day, that is 1-7-2002. Please note. 1-7-2002. See, the beauty of it is, 99 amendment, both these acts came to force on the same day. So what is the sanctity of 99 amendment? Has it gone? Not gone fully. Was it amended further? Yes. So 99 Amendment Act was further amended, altered, added something in 2002. So while studying CPC, what you have to do, there will be a footnote amended by the CPC Amendment Act 99, CPC Amendment Act 2002. What you have to do is, you have to understand what is the position before 99. Understand what is the change brought in 99. Understand the change which is brought out in 2002 amendment. What was the further amendment, etc. Then make a chart of it once for all, study it completely. Then after 1-7-2002, when these amendments act came into force, Salem Advocate Bar Association filed a case before the Supreme Court challenging a repetition before the Supreme Court challenging the validity of these acts, constitutional validity of these acts. That came up before the Supreme Court for final hearing. At that time, the Salem Bar Association said that they may be prepared, they may be permitted to withdraw them. Supreme Court said no withdrawal. This is a public interest litigation, the nature of a public interest litigation. Therefore, we will not allow you to withdraw it. We will consider it. And the Supreme Court appointed an amicus curiae, advocate, senior advocate Vaidyanath, was appointed as amicus curiae. And then appointed a committee headed by a retired Supreme Court judge, and later he was named Justice Jagannath Rao, who is a retired Supreme Court judge, very eminent person and knowledgeable person. He was our Chief Justice in the Kerala High Court also, and a very sober man. He was appointed as the chairman. Do you know who are all the members in the committee? Two lawyers, eminent lawyers, Mr. Kapil Sibal and Mr. Arun Jaitley. These two eminent members of the bar were members of the committee. and D.V. Subbarao, the chairman of the Bar Council, and then other eminent persons were also members of the committee. The committee was requested by the Supreme Court to submit reports about the amendments, and if there are something changes or interpretations to be made about that, and also submit model case flow management rules, arbitrations, etc., rules, etc. And they submitted various reports. These reports were considered by the Supreme Court again, and a final judgment was passed. There are two judgments which, dear friends, lawyers or otherwise, law students, you must read threadbare. I will give the citation. We will conveniently call it Salem 1 and Salem 2. Salem Advocate Bar Association, Tamil Nadu versus Union of India. Salem 1 citation is 2003-1 SCC, that is by Justice B.N. Kripal C.J. and Y.K. Justice Y.K. Sabharwal and Justice Arijit Pasai, three judges. And finally, it was considered by the Supreme Court for Justice Y.K. Sabharwal and Justice Dharmadhikari and Justice Tarun Chatterjee. That is called Salem 2 for conveniency, and it is reported in 2005-6 SCC 344. I am not particularly referring to the various paragraphs, there is no time. Each and every provision in the Amendment Act was considered by the Supreme Court and said that there are some provisions which are directory only, it is not compulsory. For example, I will give an example of return statement. Originally, as per the 99 Act, Order 8 Amendment, return statement was to be filed within 30 days. And the 2002 amendment, they said that it can be filed within 90 days if the court permits. You have to make an application, etc. And what will happen after 90 days? Nothing was said. And in Salem Bar Association, Salem 2, the Supreme Court said that even thereafter, the court will not become powerless. Court can do it. And they gave an example. Suppose, for the purpose of filing the written statement, a person comes to the court to meet the lawyer. And meanwhile, he got involved in an accident. And he was in the hospital for more than 3 months. What will happen to his case? There are situations which are beyond the control of a party. Then the court must have residual powers. Where do you get the residual power? In section 151. 151 provides that nothing in this court shall be a bar to the exercise of that power inherent in the court. It is not conferment of a power, but recognition of a power which is inherent in every court. The civil court, being the civil court, has inherently certain powers. And under section 151, the civil court can do, according to justice, equity and good conscience, all that is which is not prohibited or otherwise curtailed in any other provision, whether in the CPC or in its substantive law or in any other procedure. So the court has got abundant powers to meet with the situation and do accordingly, to have a complete and adjudication of the disputes. There is no dearth of power. Power is there. And that power is there means the lawyers are also powerful. You are appearing before a court which is so powerful. The civil court can detain a person. If an order is passed by the civil court which is disobeyed, can be sent to jail. And a temporary injunction order is passed which is violated, he can be sent to jail. Such powers are also there for the civil court. And we were saying about Salem 1 and Salem 2. What is the most important provision which is introduced by the amendment? That is section 89. Settlement of disputes outside the court. That is ADR, otherwise called ADR. Which says that the court shall, after ascertaining from the parties, hearing the parties, decide whether there are elements of settlement, and if there are elements of settlement, formulate the possible terms of settlement, refer to the parties, finalize it, and refer the matter either to the arbitration or to the conciliation or judicial settlement or logadhar. Four adjudicatory fora are provided. And clauses A to C, A to D, the different procedure which provision will apply. If it is to logadhar, the Legal Service Authorities Act will apply. If it is some other thing, that will apply, etc. All these are stated. And there arose a doubt, a serious doubt about the interpretation of Section 89, and it was done in a threadbare manner, which decision also young lawyers and law students must read. I will give the citation, that is Cherian Varkey construction. Afcon Infrastructure Limited versus Cherian Varkey Constructions. Kerala High Court held that even under Section 89, even an unwilling party can be referred to arbitration. Arbitration, what is a fundamental thing? There must be an arbitration agreement between the parties. But the Kerala High Court said that after Section 89 came into force, one of the methods of ADR is arbitration, and that for which an arbitration agreement is not necessary. Even the court can adopt, even refer the case to the arbitration, even if the parties are not willing. In Afcon Infrastructure versus Cherian Varkey Constructions. That is Cherian Varkey Constructions versus Afcon. Then that was taken to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court decided it in 2010, 8 SCC 24. 2010, 8 SCC 24. By Justice R.V. Ravindran of Bangalore, Karnataka. So lucid, clear, no difficulty to read and understand, quite readable, you will not get bored, and you will understand so many things which otherwise you may not be knowing. Worth reading it to understand the real scope of Section 89. And Justice R.V. Ravindran of the Supreme Court said that the opening words, that the court will formulate the possible terms of settlement, said that the court need not do. That is a final stage in the conciliation proceedings, not in the under Section 89. And the court interchanged in clause C for the word judicial settlement. Sorry. For the word judicial settlement in the CPC, court said proper word is mediation. And clause D for the mediation, the Supreme Court said that judicial settlement is the proper word. Please read that judgment, and it will be so, it is so informative, and you will understand it. And then shall we, there are so many things to be done, even at 10 hours talk will not do for our purpose, but our time is limited. People have to go back. Eh? They will be getting bored. This old man coming and lecturing. Eh? And for your information, I am 66. I am not bored. Even now, every day, I record a video or alternate days, 2 or 3 videos, then upload it every day. After retirement, that is my joke, job. So see you, say question answer time. You can ask any question. If I know, I will say no, I know. If I do not know, I will say I do not know. So there is no boasting of anything. See, even if a top senior Supreme Court judge is asked a fundamental thing in the CPC or in any other law, probably you may not know. See, for fever, this paracetamol, that is not the Hindi law. Law is such a field which even after a full dedication of a full life, it will not be over. It is an ocean. That is the beauty of it also. You have got enough space to swim. enough space to swim. Yes, now question and answer session. You are free to ask any question. If I know, I will answer. If I do not know, I will say sorry, I don't know.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll move on to the next session, to the next segment, that is the question answer segment. So the first question is from our before that, if at all anyone have any doubts, please put it on the chat box. I've written down whoever have put it on the chat box, I've written down their names, but if anyone else have, please put it down. So far, the first question is from Mr. R. Vivekan. Please unmute yourself and ask your question, sir.
Good evening. My question is, how civil rules of practice is different from the Code of Civil Procedure? That is my first question. And is there any combination that if I read CRP and CPC, is there a match and mismatch between these two books?
CPC?
Am I audible?
Yes, audible. Second question.
And my second question is, once I have filed civil rules of practice in a trial court written by the judge, I have wanted a copy of it because they are delaying the case. So I wanted the civil proceedings, CRP proceedings of those copies. So I was refused to give that. So the judge told me, give me the provision where in which provision you are applying for this certified copies.
Yes.
You are a party to the suit?
Yes.
A party to the suit is entitled to get certified copy.
But I'm not asking plaint or any other evidences. I'm talking about the civil rule proceedings.
Ah, there you have to say, state the reason. You have to file an affidavit and state the reason why you want it.
Well, I have filed an affidavit that for the purpose of expediting the process of the court proceedings, I am interested to take the CRP proceedings. But still I was refused. But I don't find
any reason, depending on the civil rules of practice of the particular state. That is my answer. You have to find out whether there is provision. Judgment and decree, orders in the interlocutory applications, as of right, you are entitled to certified copy. Well, there are specific rules how to make an application, whether ordinary, whether urgent, and after making the copy application, what you have to do, how to produce the stamp papers, within what time you have to produce it, how to compute the period of limitation for filing an appeal. Section 12 of the Limitation Act provides for it. All these things are there. So you have to search your civil rules of practice and find whether the proceedings of the court you are entitled to copy. See, here somebody say if the matter to be produced before any other superior court, the courts are granting it.
Technically speaking, it is the discretionary power of the court.
It is not discretion. It will be provided the rules.
But the judge was asking under which provision am I applying, but I don't find any provisions.
You are from which state?
Well, I am from Hyderabad.
Hyderabad. For what purpose you want the proceedings?
Initiate proceed against the judge itself. To initiate proceedings against judge itself.
What proceeding?
Because the judgment that he gave is not a quality judgment.
There proceeding cannot be taken. There is an act which protects the judicial officers from doing it. You cannot initiate a proceeding against a judge on the ground that the judgment is bad. You have got a right of appeal. You have got a right of review.
Well, I have an appeal to do so, but my intention was to take civil matter because I want to go through CPC, connect it with civil practice. So in the sense,
yes. Which provision in the civil law? Which civil law provides a right to the litigant to file a suit against the or proceeding against the judicial officer for having rendered a judgment? On the other hand, there is a bar under the particular statute. I do not know the name. That is protection of the judicial officers.
Well, section 4 of the service law
is not service law. There is a special statute for it. And then section 9 will apply. Because of that act, there is an implied bar under section 9 of the CPC.
In case in future, if I want to apply, is there any provision?
It is not application. What is the purpose? So here the purpose, you will not get it. You are not entitled to get it. And how many years of practice you have got?
3 years.
How many years of practice you have got?
Three years.
3 years. Dear friend, can I give you an advice?
Yes.
Don't venture to do it.
Your voice was cracking, sorry.
Don't venture to do it. That will not give you good reputation.
I get it.
Don't do it.
I get it.
So if you are aggrieved, see, there are judgments, there are good judgments, bad judgments. Suppose a municipal, a civil court, say, junior division officer renders a judgment. An appeal is provided, second appeal is provided. Sometimes, if the first appeal is to the High Court, then the appeal to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court reverses all the judgments. Sometimes the municipal judgment may be correct.
Well, I know.
Suppose the Supreme Court or High Court interferes with the trial court judgment, that does not mean that the High Court is always right or Supreme Court is always right. Because the Supreme Court is right because it is final. Not that the trial court's judgment is wrong. I have seen several judgments of the Supreme Court where the trial court judgment was restored and on the judgment of the district court as well as High Court were set aside. So it is not, I was a High Court judge for 12 years. One of my judgments was reversed by the Supreme Court, by the Chief Justice of India and another. On reading the Supreme Court judgment, I found that is foolish judgment. I cannot use that expression. It is not a correct judgment. My judgment was correct. And it provided justice to the parties. But Supreme Court is Supreme Court. I cannot file a case against the Supreme Court. See, if a judgment is wrong, you have got a built-in method to file an appeal, file a second appeal, file further appeal to the Supreme Court. And the Law Commission and the various thought across the country is that reduce the number of appeals. Why appeals are there? Because it is not the word of mouth of a particular individual. It is subject to correction by the appellate court. It is not so in very, very many other countries. Criminal case. A person is to be given capital punishment. What are all the steps to be taken? The Sessions Court gives that judgment. And if a punishment is provided, capital punishment is provided, there is compulsory reference to the High Court. The High Court has to confirm it. Then only it becomes there. Then time is there to Supreme Court. And then mercy petition to the Rashtrapati. All these things are there. There are some other countries, if a judgment is passed, to hang next day, finished. That is not our system. Our system is unique. Delay is bound to occur. Or if the allegation is that there is a theft, cut off your hand. See, one person says that, the one judge says, all right, this evidence is believed, has cut off his hands. After hand is cut off, what will be done? Then the appellate court reverses. Appeal is provided, but not as good as in our system. Our system is perfect on that. Delay is there, no doubt about it. Delay will be there. But a person will not be. See how Saddam Hussein was hanged. In what manner he was executed. All who were against his acts felt sorry about him. And he was, people across the world was on his side so far as this execution of sentence is concerned. He was not given justice. On the other hand, he has done so much of injustice to the Iraqi people. But still he was not provided justice at the time of trial and at the time of execution. That every a person having a sense of justice will not approve that. whereas that will never happen in India. There are enough methods. So, dear friend, please desist from doing it. You may file an appeal, that's all. Yes.
Thank you, R. Vivekan, sir. The next question is from Deva Borini. Ma'am, ma'am, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
I am taking his question.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative class. So I wanted to know, can you just please enlighten something about discovery and admission?
Yes. What is?
So discovery and admission.
Discovery and inspection. Order 11, CPC. That chapter is discovery and inspection. Order 11. Right?
Ma'am?
Sir, I want to know about order 11 as well as order 12.
Order?
11 as well as order 12.
Order 11, rule by rule, it is not possible. Order rules 1 to 11 and 22 relate to interrogatories. Yes. 1 to 11 and 22 relate to interrogatories. And discovery rules 12 to 21. Please read, understand the commentaries also. You may read. It is not possible. Discovery, inspection, putting interrogatories. Interrogatories occur at discovery and inspection occurs at the earlier stages of the game. It is not a method of oppression of the opposite side. It is a method by which you can save valuable time of yourself, your opponent. Valuable time of the board. It can minimize the volume of evidence. If you get several details from your opponent, suppose after reading the plain and written statement, certain facts are not, the pleadings do not contain evidence. Order 6 particularly states that pleadings should not contain evidence. Evidence will be adduced at the time of trial. We do not know what evidence will abruptly come in. So there are several gray areas. If you get an idea about what are the real points which the court has to consider and you have to meet as a reply, and certain questions will elucidate, you are entitled to put forward those questions and submit before court, and it will be served to the opposite side, and the opposite side's their objection will be taken. And then court will pass an order. All right, you answer these questions. Then the opposite party has to answer it. And those answers will be taken as admissions or as such, it will go in evidence. So that the time of the court, time of the parties, voluminous evidence can be avoided. Much money can be saved. And otherwise, you will have to search and find out several documents, several witnesses are to be examined. All those things can be avoided by getting just a mere answer on certain matters, elucidating the point. Or for inspection, certain documents can be produced. You are not in possession of a particular document, your opponent is in possession. He is not producing before court. Of course, a document which he should produce, if he does not produce, an adverse inference can be drawn. But that does not always create such a situation. But there is a document in the possession of your opponent on which you can rely on, he is not producing before court. He can be compelled to produce it. Then the court can inspect it. You can inspect it. All those procedures are provided. That is order 11. So we cannot have a detailed class on order 11 because it will take at least 1 hour, 1.5 hours. And then say if that order is not obeyed, your pleading can be struck off. Rule 16 of Order 11 provides. Since you asked that question, striking off pleadings, what are the provisions? Order 11, Rule 21, striking off pleadings. Order 6, Rule 16, striking off pleadings. Order 6, Rule 14A, Subrule 5, striking off pleadings. These are the three provisions where the court can exercise that power, drastic power of striking off the defense, striking off the pleadings. What will happen if the defense is struck off? The defendant is directed to produce a document or to answer the interrogators. He disobeys. Order 6, rule 2, Order 11, Rule 21. Just immediately for the sake, I will read. Order 11, Rule 21. Yes, non-compliance with the order for discovery, where any party fails to comply with the order to answer interrogatories or for discovery or inspection of documents, he shall, if a plaintiff, be liable to have his suit dismissed for want of prosecution, and if a defendant, to have his defense, if any, struck out and to be placed in the same position as if he had not defended, and the party interrogatory or seeking discovery may apply to the court for an order. Very drastic step. See, I am the plaintiff, you are the defendant, your defense is struck out, then that means I automatically win. Almost 99.99, it is sure that I will succeed, because there is nobody to defend. There is no goalkeeper. I can kick and get goals without any goalkeeper there in the opposite post. That is striking off defense. It is a very drastic step that the court can take. That is there in Order 11, Rule 21. And there are other portions also. Order 6, Rule 17. Scandalous, frivolous, vexatious. I file a suit against you for recovery of money. And in the plaint, I say that the defendant is a notorious man. His character is not good. He has got a wife. And then he has got illicit relationships with other five ladies. And he has got children in those relationships. What is the relevance in a money suit? Not at all. So it is scandalous, vexatious, frivolous. The court has power to strike out the scene. And above all, Section 151. A question arose before the Kerala High Court. It was decided by Justice Varghese Kalyan. I argued that. In Ottapalam court, a lady, an old lady, was directed to appear and give her finger impression for the purpose of comparison of her finger impression in a will. She had taken a defense that she had not executed the gift deed. She had not executed that gift deed. She had not registered it. That was the contention. The opposite side, that is my party, thought that she will die immediately. So ailing, so old. But she did not die. The other side filed an application to get her thumb impression. She evaded. Ultimately, her pleadings were struck off. Then the matter was taken before the High Court. And the High Court Justice Varghese Kalyan held that the court has power apart from Order 6, Rule 16, the court has power under Section 151 also, following two Madras decisions. So read these rules, interrogatories, etc. It is at the early stage of the litigation to shorten the litigation. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Mr. Nawaz. Please unmute yourself and ask your question, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
First of all, I thank you very much for such a wonderful and insightful session on Civil Procedure Code. And moreover, you have taught us the technique as to how to love the CPC with a genuine example of how to love a girl. Really appreciate it. And the second thing, to appreciate...
Love is a very sublime act.
You are telling your 66. First of all,
love is a very sublime act.
You are highly dynamic, enthusiastic, and still draws you give inspiration to the legal fraternity members, students, and all. So my question is, it is generally believed and it is generally seen that in case of civil proceedings, in case of civil cases, inordinate delay takes place for the final disposal of that. So we are living in an information technology era where we get everything on fingertips, especially in the light of the virtual courts now. Though we were constrained to adopt to that method because of the pandemic, lockdown and other things. But things have changed a lot. Gone are those days when one has to post a letter to the postman, send it, then delivers, and all those things are already good. With the support and help and assistance of the modern technology, is it not possible to have expeditious disposal of the civil proceedings? Or the, I mean, final disposal of the civil litigation. What is the bottleneck in that? Or it will still remain conventional one? As a former judge of the High Court, you know better how many years does it take for a civil plaint to reach the final decree? At times 10 years, even 20 years. By that time, the litigant might have died also. So the justice delayed is justice denied, even in the case of civil suits. So is there any mechanism that at least in the near future can we expect expeditious disposal of the litigations? Thank you, sir.
Yes, your question is very, very important. This, even if you read the first Law Commission report or the initial years, they were worried about, and there was discussion in the floor of the parliament about the delay disposal of cases, civil as well as criminal. That is a worry all over the world, not only in India. Whenever you read about lawyers, even if you read a book about the jokes about the lawyers, they will say yes. About the delay and causing inconvenience to the parties.
Yes, yes.
That is even a joke that when you go to a lawyer, you are finished and you will never, that is there about the doctors also. There was a dermatologist, a skin specialist. Yes. His son is also a skin specialist. Yes. So this skin specialist father had to go to some place for 1 week. So an old client, patient came, and this son, youngster, cured it.
Yes.
And when the father came, he said, "I have cured that." And the father said, "Fool, you have studied MBBS, all the children were taught, and the household was being run with the help of such patients over the years. So don't completely cure." That is where there is such theory. There are some lawyers also. There are some lawyers also who are experts in dragging the procedure. I will give you an example which happened in a court.
Yes.
There is a lawyer known for protracting. He is not alive now. There was a lawyer who was known for protracting and second round litigation and all those things. And he will be engaged to protract the cases.
Yes.
So there was an appeal before the district court. This lawyer was engaged to drag the proceedings.
Yes,
so the case was called by the district judge. Once the lawyer was not there, this particular lawyer, it was passed over. Passed over, then again called. Then again the lawyer was not there. Third time passed over. Then again it was called. Lawyer was not there. The district judge got impatient. Yeah. He dismissed the appeal for default. Then within 5 minutes, the lawyer was waiting outside and seeing the drama here. And within 5 minutes, the lawyer came and then appeared. Then the district judge said, "So and so, I have dismissed your appeal for default. All right, it doesn't matter. I will restore it. You may argue."
You will get another opportunity.
then the lawyer replied, "Your Honor, am I to argue a dismissed appeal? All things are to be done.
Mm-hmm.
I have to file an application for restoration. That has to be done within 30 days. If I do not do it, there will be delay. Then I'll have to file an application for condonation.
Yes, yes.
Your Honor may dismiss it. Then I will have to take up the matter to the High Court. Then the matter comes there." See?
Right.
Such techniques are being adopted by lawyers.
But these days, sir, clients are very, very informed. They are informed. They are updated.
All right.
Now it is not easy to before
my a client. Answer is this. Yeah. Lawyers must realize.
Yes,
lawyers
sir.
Also must realize that quick disposal of the case will not affect their practice at all.
Yeah.
On the other hand, the number of cases in the civil courts will increase. If a civil case is filed, it can be disposed of within 6 months or 1 year.
Yes, yes.
Parties will
Yes.
Parties will rush to the civil court and get decisions.
Number and of appeals will be high.
Question I used to ask in the Kerala Judicial Academy for young judicial officers who come for 1 year training is that. This is a usual question which I ask.
Yes, sir.
Suppose something happened to your property, your neighbor invades you. What will you do?
Sir?
Suppose your neighbor attempts to trespass upon your property. What will you do? And the uniform answer is go to the police station. The question is repeated, will you go to the civil court? No, sir, we will not. They are going to be judicial officers.
Without knowing the distinction between civil and criminal cases. Eh?
No, they know the distinction. They know the delay also.
Yes.
So it is notorious. So my personal request to the young lawyers is, the moment the cases are filed, it is up to the advantage of the legal profession in the long run that quick disposals take place in the civil court. So all the lawyers must strive hard to attain that object so that the people will have more faith in the system. Mm. And instead of going to the police station and approaching extrajudicial remedies, attempting extrajudicial remedies, they will come to the civil court. In Bombay, I am told that if a tenant is to be evicted, nobody goes to the court, but there are agencies.
But on the part of the police, is it lawful to interfere into this kind of civil matters and settling?
It's not lawful to interfere in civil disputes, but every day they are doing it.
But we can resort to ADR mechanism as well, no? We can resort to ADR mechanism.
Pre-litigation ADR is there.
Yes, yes.
But still, in arbitration matters, what happens? In India, arbitration agreements are signed. But the parties agree, venue of arbitration, Singapore. Why?
Yes, sir.
Because they know that in India it will be tracked. So it is high time that our lawyers must realize that the most expeditious disposal of civil, criminal or any other type of case in court will be to their advantage in their long run. And all the lawyers must strive hard to dispose it. Insofar as the state of Kerala is concerned, I remember in 2015, the total number of cases in the subordinate courts filed during that year was 13,50,000. And the total number of disposal was around 15 lakhs, more than the filing. So we have attained that. And within 2 years, a suit will be disposed, even before that. So there is not much delay in the disposal of cases. Still, it may happen. Some nature of the property may be. Some measurement is required. Survey is required. Survey, if you address the taluk surveyor, it takes how many months to get a survey report? So what the courts are now doing is that village officer is enough, or village assistant is enough, or private surveyor is enough. For survey work, it is that specialized man's requirement is there. So you cannot always find.
Yeah, such inherent infirmities are there.
Yeah.
Such inherent infirmities are there.
I still believe that if the lawyers work hard and they have a mind, they have an inclination, they have got a genuine desire to
have a disposal
at the earliest. And it is up to your advantage itself. In the long run, people will always come to court.
Yes. And the case of the criminal cases are also like that, sir, these days. Even 173 report is being filed after 2 years, 2 to 3 years or 4 years.
Yes.
Depending on the discretion of the investigating officer.
Yes.
Whereas CRPC lays down that within 24 hours you have to submit a report, which is not possible. So in one way, investigating agencies are taking advantage of the provisions of the CRPC by taking their own sweet time. Similarly, as you have rightly said, the lawyers should also take more initiative to see that their clients are disposed of expeditiously. Then which ultimately, as you rightly said, will not affect their profession.
Never. When editor was there, I remember in Kerala High Court, mediation center was opened. And to start with, the lawyers were apprehensive that their practice will be affected. And the lawyers were given training for mediation. Yes, accredited mediators were there. And you know what happened in the Kerala High Court?
Yes.
A stage came where both parties come to the court and say that our case may be sent to the mediation. Particularly matrimonial matters, when an appeal is filed, it is admitted at that time, the appellant's lawyer will say, maybe sent to mediation if the other side comes. The other side comes, it is posted before court on a particular day. The other side also agrees, matter is referred for mediation within 2 weeks, the whole thing is settled. And the lawyers find it is lucrative because the state government pays 3,000.
Effort is less.
Less.
Yes,
and people are happy.
Yes.
I remember a case which came before us. I was leading the bench. There are three or four cases between husband and wife. Husband's case is that the wife's case for divorce is that the husband is important.
Restitutional control right. No. Husband also filed the case.
Now case of the husband is that the wife is a sexual maniac.
Okay.
How to hold these parallel lines join?
Yes.
Excuse me, sir.
They got divorced, they got separated or rejoined?
Separated. Husband had to pay 25 lakhs to the wife.
Oh, God.
He had taken dowry.
Yes.
He had appropriated the ornaments. And extra was paid. 25 lakhs, yes. Got divorced. Both happy. So where is the impotency? Where is the sexual mania?
Within 2 weeks, everything got settled.
Everything settled for money.
I'm really sorry. I'll have to intervene here now because we have a lot of other questions and we are running out.
Yes.
Thank you, Niranjana. Thank you for allowing such a question, and it was a wonderful session. Thank you for coordinating such a wonderful webinar.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for attending.
Okay.
The next question is from Amal Ehsan. There's a request to all the participants. Please keep your questions short because we have a lot of other questions to be answered. So the next question is from Amal Ehsan. Please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Sir, good evening. Am I audible?
Yes, audible.
Sir, I'm a law student studying in second year. And so glad to hear your beautiful lecture for 2 hours. Sir, my question is about the ex parte order. If the court has passed an ex parte order, what are the criteria do the courts consider to accept the request from the defendant to consider it again? Or do the defendant have any other solution to approach the superior?
Yes, I will answer. Your answer is, you will find it in order 9. If you are a defendant and an ex parte decree or order is passed against you, you can make an application under rule 13 of order 9. If you are a plaintiff, your suit is dismissed for default on account of your absence, you can make an application under order 9, rule 9.
Sir, as you were already mentioned, section 151, that is the residual powers of the High Court. Sir, if such an order is passed from the lower court, that if such an order is arbitrary, do the High Courts have the power to interfere or intervene such an order with such an order?
See, the High Court's power of revision, even suo motu revision, can be taken. That power undoubted. But the High Court will not do it when you have got an effective opportunity, effective remedy, alternative remedy. You have got a, you can file an application under Order 9 Rule 13 to set aside an ex parte order or decree, and you have got a remedy to restore the suit if you are a plaintiff which was dismissed for default under Order 9 Rule 9. So first resort to it. And if there is delay, there is power to control the delay under Section 5 of the Limitation Act. Yes. Then you need not go to the High Court. If you are, and then one more thing, if your application to set aside the ex parte decree is dismissed, you have got a right of appeal under Order 43 as an appeal from an order. If your application is allowed, there is no appeal for the opposite side. There is only revision. That is the beauty of it. You have to see, I will give an example. A decree is passed, it is appealable under Section 96. Second appeal is under Section 90. If it is an order, it is appealable only if it is made appealable under Section 104, read with Order 43. Then only an appeal lies. Whereas every decree is appealable. Otherwise, it is barred. So if it is an order, there is a difference between decree and order. You will get the definition of decree under Order 2, Rule 2. Section 2, 2, and order under some other provision, Section 2 itself. That is formal expression of an adjudication so far as the parties are concerned on every matter in issue, maybe either preliminary or final, shall be deemed to include the rejection of a plaint and determination of a position under Section 144, but does not include a dismissal for default or an order from which an appeal lies as an appeal from an order. These are the ingredients of 2-2.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Your class was, it was very beneficial for all of us, especially the law students, as we are learning from the beginning. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Amal. The next question is from D. Jyoti Kumar, sir. I'll be asking his question on his behalf. Regarding filing application in Kerala Administrative Tribunal, for person one, jurisdiction only at Trivandrum. For person 2, jurisdiction only at Ernakulam. Cause of action is same. So P1 and P2 wants to file joint application. Whether joint application can be filed in this case? If so, which bench it can be filed, Trivandrum or Ernakulam?
I do not know. I have not gone to the administrative tribunal. I have not practiced there. And the exact the question which is put, see, I have not thought of it, so I will say I am ignorant. Yes.
Okay. So the next question is from Prem Anand. Sir, please unmute yourself and ask your question. Sir. So we'll move on to the next question. The next question, oh wait, sir has unmuted himself, so he'll ask his question.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Good evening, sir. So your presentation was wonderful, sir. Very informative, and it was a difficult topic, but still you made it very jovial and very halwa-like examples. You took cake-like examples, and we enjoyed it very well. All of us must have got a lot from your lecture. Okay, let me go to the question, sir. I am from Kerala. I am a law student. So
which college?
I am studying in Bangalore, Patil Law College. Okay. Sir, and my case is that in case of disobedience of a decree in civil case, detention is possible. Detention.
Disobedience of an order of injunction.
Yeah, order of injunction. Yeah, exactly. So is there any limit?
Obedience of decree executes.
Yeah. Is there any limit, the maximum period that can be awarded as a punishment in the case, in
yes,
this case?
Yes, it is. Yeah. Okay. I think I remember it is 3 months.
3 months. Max. Mm.
It is there. Okay. Order 39, Rule 2A.
Okay.
Order 39. Now itself, I will clear that out. Yeah. Order 39, Rule 2A.
Order 39, Rule 2A.
There was a Kerala amendment which was gone now. Kerala amendment was 6 months detention, but that amendment will not stand after the amendment of CPC. Hmm. I think it is 3 months.
3 months.
3 months, Rule 2A.
Okay.
In the book which I have, that is in Kerala, amendment with Kerala, that will not survive now because of the amendment of CPC.
Okay, sir, thank you so much.
It's 3 months.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Jason P. Jones. Please unmute yourself, sir, and ask your question.
Sir, good evening.
Good
evening. Sir, my question is that one suit is decreed. One suit is decreed, and suit is one for injunction. Injunction. Even though the prior is otherwise, the suit decreed the width of way is fixed by the Honorable Court is 6 feet, that is in the decree, 6 feet. And as per the commission report also, commission report is form part of the decree also.
Yes.
Now what happened is that the plaintiff himself is reduced of the width. Plaintiff himself reduced of the width. Then what is the relief of the defendant. Defendant wants
after reducing the width, the property, he gained something from that pathway. Did you understand the question? See, this 6 feet way was provided as per the decree.
My doubt is if the defendant violate the decree, there are some remedies are there. But if the plaintiff himself is violated the decree, this is not a compromise decree. The only remedy, to my information, is to file a separate suit by the defendant. Whether there is any other remedy for the violation
depends on facts. If it comes in execution, section 47 is there. Section 47 CPC says that all questions relating to execution, discharge or satisfaction of the decree shall be decided by the court executing it and not by a separate suit. So you have to see whether a separate suit is barred. You have to, the facts which are given are not sufficient for arriving at a conclusion. Detailed facts are required, and how whose property forms part of the pathway is a matter to be looked into. If the defendant plaintiff himself has annexed a portion of the property to his property, and whether execution proceedings are there and he has got it executed, then the same executing court can redress the grievance. And by moving an application, it can be done. I am not giving a complete answer to it because the facts given are insufficient for giving a complete answer. These are all the areas which you may look up. If you file a separate suit, whether it will constitute a bar under section 47 of the CPC, or whether the easiest method of applying under section 47 is enough. If it is within 3 years, and if it is an application under section 47, the article which is applicable under the Limitation Act is article 137. It is 3 years period. If there is a bar under section 47, then you cannot file a fresh suit. Yes, these are all the things to be looked at. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Farmila Sherin. Ma'am, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes. Good evening, sir. Sir, I would like to get an overview on section 47 of CPC. Just you mentioned here now. Please give an overview, sir.
Section 47, if you take the commentary, it will run to hundreds of pages.
Yeah, that's...
It's a very difficult section. Very difficult section. And even in one of the sessions in CPC, various places, even a webinar was there for young lawyers where we discussed it. What is the scope of Section 47 in such cases is sometimes becomes doubtful. On a particular point, see, I will give an example. Under Article 134 of the Limitation Act, for getting delivery of a property which is decreed, is 1 year. Suppose 1 year is over, what will happen? I am an auction purchaser in court auction. I get title on the date of sale under Section 65 CPC. I have to get delivery. Article 134 provides for a 1 year period. After 1 year, what will happen? Whether a suit can be filed. One decision says that, two decisions say that suit can be filed. Supreme Court. What larger bench decision 73 or so said that no suit lies. There are other decisions also, conflicting opinion even by the Supreme Court. That you may see the session on Limitation Act under Section 15(4) of the Limitation Act, why I dealt with that. You may see that link from, get that link from Niranjana, and you will get that episode under Section 15(4) of the Limitation Act. You will get it. And that is not in a final answer to Section 47. Section 47 is very, very, very vast. 47 says that all questions relating, all questions arising between the parties to the suit or their representatives and relating to execution, discharge, or satisfaction of the decree shall be decided by the court executing it and not by a Supreme Court. Why? Because protracting type of litigation should be avoided. That is a prime object. And there are certain amendments in 1976 also precede that. And if you go through the scheme of the CPC, Order 21 Rule, Order 21 Rule 58, and then Order 21 Rule 63 omitted, Order 21 Rule 97 to 104, you see the change which was brought out in 1976. Till 1976, if a claim is put forward at the time of delivering the property, at the time in execution, a claim is put forward by a third party, and some party loses, he could file a suit. But now, after 1976, that is taken away. He can make an application, an appeal is provided, as if it is a trial of an issue that will be decided. All questions related to right, title, and interest will be decided in the same execution proceeding itself and not by a separate suit. You may see Rule 103 of Order 21, Rule 58 of Order 21. Everything in this, say, two-tier litigation has been reduced to single-tier litigation, to save time and to avoid delay in disposing of matters. So that is the object of the amendment of CPC in 1976 in these areas. And likewise, 47 is amended. Still there is doubt. I will give another example. When a court sale takes place, there are three remedies open. Under Rule 89, the JD can file an application, judgment debtor can file an application to set aside the sale after depositing the amount which is to be realized under the execution plus cost plus 5% excess. Yes. It can be set aside. And it is as of right. Once you do it within 60 days, your property is sold in court auction, purchased by a third party, you will get back the property. And you have got, let's say, the aggrieved party has got another right, that is under Rule 90, to set aside the sale on the ground of material irregularity or fraud in publishing and conducting the sale plus certain other ingredients. Then the sale will be set aside. Rule 91, sale can be set aside at the instance of the auction purchaser on the ground that the judgment debtor had no valid title. These are all the things possible. Now, the question is, when such application is to be filed under, say, for example, under Rule 90, to set aside the sale on the ground of material irregularity or fraud, the period of limitation is 60 days. 61st day, you are out. Why? Because Section 5 of the Limitation Act will not apply. Section 5 of the Limitation Act, the wording is that other than appeals and applications, other than an application under Order 21, Section 5, which speaks of extension of time, otherwise called condonation of delay, applies only to appeals and applications other than an application under Order 21 of the Code of Civil Procedure. That means in execution matters, the court has no power to condone delay. So in an application under Rule 90 is not filed within 60 days. And if an application is filed under Section 47, you will get the period of limitation 3 years. So there is an area, there is a transgression of this into that. And that is a very, very nice distinction, a gray area even now. And Justice Balasubramaniam of the Kerala High Court said that even if an application under Rule 90 is dismissed, if an application is otherwise maintainable under 47, there is nothing wrong in adopting that. That was decided in 99 also. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Mr. Ojesh. I hope, sir, it's fine. We have like we have three more questions and then we'll wind it up. So the next question is from Mr. Ojesh. Please unmute yourself, sir, and ask your question.
A very good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Wonderful lecture, and you have presented a very comprehensive, distinct, insightful information about the entire civil procedure in a very short span of time. Sir, my question is focused on the execution part. Sir, it is well understood that once a person gets a decree, the more difficult portion lies when the execution of the decree comes.
Yes.
So,
my question... The Privy Council has said, somebody first question was regarding delay. One Privy Council decision says that in India, the most difficult part is execution.
Yes, sir. So my question is, sir, regarding money suits in execution of a money decree. If we go to the provisions of Section 55 CPC, there is an express bar for executing the mode of execution by way of arrest against a woman.
56.
CPC. So my question is, when the same mode of execution of arrest is being allowed for the enforcement of a decree for restitution of conjugal rights. So I have been thinking, sir, as to why there is such a difference in when there is an execution for money decree, the same is barred, the same option is barred, but it's not so in the case of restitution of conjugal rights. So what is the difference, I would like to know, sir?
Yes. See, a lady can be arrested if she has committed a crime, she can be detained, there is no harm. Mm-hmm. Why Section 56? In respect of a money decree, in execution of a decree for payment of money, a woman cannot be arrested and detained in civil prison. That is our culture, reflection of Indian culture.
Mm-hmm.
Reflection of Indian culture. We have got maternity leave for 90 days. And now central government paternity leave for 15 days. In which country it has got? Make a search.
Mm-hmm.
Make a search and find out in the internet. I do not know how to do all those things.
So,
and I challenge this to the young lawyers and law students. So this is reflection of our Indian culture and tradition. We don't want a lady to be arrested and detained in civil prison only on the ground that she could not pay the money.
Mm-hmm.
That is respecting ladies, even though they fight for their equality. We should not, on the ground of equality, detain a lady. That is against our culture.
Sir, what is the option left to the litigant, to the decree holder in such a case?
Because restitution of conjugal rights, she is a party, she has to obey. In respect of a money decree, there are various modes of execution.
Yes, sir. But in cases where we cannot find the assets of the particular judgment debtor, it becomes difficult for the litigant, who is also a woman, to realize the fruits of the decree. So is it that she has to wait for till the assets are available, or till she is substantially fine?
That risk is there even if he is a man. There may be persons who are having real money, but yes, you do not know what whether it is available. Money is there, but he spends also, but nobody knows where it is. Same order rule 41 of order 21 provides for compelling the other party to file an affidavit.
Yes, yes, sir.
That is possible. And then arrest and detention, civil prison, if he has got means. Section 51 proviso clause B says that a person who does not have asset or means, realizable asset, cannot be detained.
Mm-hmm.
And what is the ingredient to be proved? That he has or has had since the date of the decree the means to pay the decree debt, and he refuses or has refused to pay the same. That is the ingredient. 51 proviso clause B.
Yes.
So even if there is a decree, once upon a time he may be rich, but he has fallen into evil days before the decree, mm-hmm, then he cannot be arrested in detail in civil prison. This is the ingredient. Clause B, that the judgmentor, if the court is satisfied that the judgmentor has or has had since the date of the decree the means to pay the amount of decree or some substantial part thereof and refuses or neglects or has refused or neglected to pay the same. If after the decree, suppose the decree is passed in January 2020, he has squandered the money and he has no money in March or so August, that is not a ground to escape from the detention civil prison. He has had the money. And there are two decisions of Justice Krishnaiah. One in 1969, Kerala High Court. His Lordship refers to the international covenants and the human rights. And that is repeated as a Supreme Court judge in 1980 Supreme Court. Please verify. Jolly George or something.
Jolly George. Yes.
Yes.
Sir, would it also cover cases where after the decree has been passed, the judgmentor has disposed of his property?
Yes, that is possible. Section 51 itself.
Yes.
51 itself provides that.
Mm-hmm.
Other clause. He has committed an act of bad faith.
Yes.
Or contumacious conduct on his part. He can be detained. Judgmentor with the object or obstructing or delaying the execution of the decree has, after the institution of the suit in which the decree was passed, dishonestly transferred, concealed or removed any part of his property or committed any other act of bad faith in relation to his property. He can be arrested in detail.
Sir, my short question, sir, a second part is, if that particular judgment debtor has a share in her undivided property of her father, can we apply to the court for attachment of that share?
Sure.
For sale?
Sure. Whatever right the judgmentor has, it can be attached and sold.
Okay.
And the auction purchaser has to apply for symbolic delivery under Rule 96 of Order 21 and then file a suit for partition to get that share.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, the next question is from Sachidananda, sir. Sir, please unmute yourself and ask a question.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I am the daughter of Advocate Sachidananda Pai.
I am
a law student.
Sachidananda Pai argued over two or three criminal appeals before me.
Yes, sir. He told me he know you. First of all, excuse me for asking a question which is out of today's topic. Since the internship is a major part of our study, I believe that there must be some suggestion from you as to may the best order for proceed with. I'm a second year student now. And as of now, I intern with an NGO. I'm studying in Symbiosis Law College.
Yes, internship, so far as internship is concerned. See, don't take that I am boasting.
Okay.
I am answering to your question. It may be helpful to you. That is, don't take it that I am boasting.
Okay, sir.
When I was a judge, sitting judge in the Kerala High Court, law students used to come to me. Internship. What I will do is that I will ask them to go to different courts in the High Court, different benches, study everything, meet me once or twice a day, have some discussion and go on. Nothing more than that. I could not do anything. At that time, once I remember, I was the president of the Kerala Judicial Academy. At that time, the training for young judicial officers was going on in the High Court premises. High Court building itself, that was the old Judicial Academy. I contacted the director, who later became a High Court judge, Justice A.M. Babu, who was a district judge at that time. And I asked him whether they can be accommodated in the academy. It is possible. And these people were sent to the academy so that they could attend the classes which were being provided to the judicial officers. They were very happy. And then it continued. So the Kerala Judicial Academy, whose doors were not opened for anybody other than judicial officer, was opened for the first time by me for the law students. Then law students used to flock in from various parts of Kerala. And a stage came, later I became a chairperson of the Kerala Judicial Academy after my retirement. I was there for 3 years. And the Kerala Judicial Academy became the only institution where large number of law students were accommodated as internees. And even queries came from Jammu and Kashmir. How you are doing it? I do not know the position now. My term is over, therefore I am not saying it is not proper for me to say anything. You contact the Kerala Judicial Academy. At that time, there was a process. You could apply online and you will be provided a seat in the library. You can look at any book you want. There is no camera. There is no hidden thing. There is no CCTV. We say to the law students, we believe you, dear friends. It is your institution. You can come anytime. And to my experience, no law student has ever destroyed any property belonging to the High Court or to the Judicial Academy. It is notorious that the law students are otherwise misused. But they have never done it in the Kerala Judicial Academy, because at the inception, I used to say that it is your institution. We will not peep through. We will not watch. You are having free access to the three-storied library. Everywhere you can come in. And training is going on. You can go there and sit. Those are all the things which were introduced at that time of my tenure. I do not know what is the position now. You contact the Kerala Judicial Academy. If that is available, that is the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It's always nice to meet a fellow Symbian, because even we are from Symbiosis. Both of us are from Symbiosis Law School, Pune. Please let us know which Symbi you are from in the chat box, so it will be nice to get to know. So the last question is from Mr. R. Vivekan again. Sir, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
It's the same person once again. I'm just curious to know. I don't know how it functions in Kerala, but here when it comes to Malayalis, we got little bit reputation when we contest in civil matters. So my question is, even I am also curious to know what is that you teach in Judicial Academy?
To judicial officers.
Yes, we have a concept here in Telangana called the Junior Civil Judge Program, containing 22 subjects.
Yes, yeah. What we teach at the Judicial Academy, there is a compulsory 1 year training program for young judicial officers who are appointed, principal magistrates, entry level officers, that is junior grade. They will be given 1 year training. 1 year, first 3 months, then 2 months practical experience, then they will come back again 2 months, like that. Total period will be 1 year. So there will be theory classes in the Kerala Judicial Academy, where we, the judges go there, directors take classes, outsiders also come, top people come, various parts of India, they render lectures. Then practical training, we are providing training for postmortem, for FSL, then jails, village officers, taluk officers, survey, and various forest and other places, they'll be taken for the purpose of practical understanding of various provisions of various laws, so that after 1 year practice, they will be pakka. Pakka judicial officers, well trained. Then there may be some, you may find one lazy man, one recalcitrant man, one mischievous man. That is, we can't help. Yes.
Thank you, sir. With that, we come to an end to our question and answer interactive session. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank everyone who participated.
One more thing.
Yes, sir.
There are several webinars in Kerala. Two webinars at Calicut I have to attend because he is the person, the advocate who conducts and conducted training classes in the Kerala Judicial Academy. On my request, he has taken classes. Therefore, I
have Shyambadman, sir.
Shyambadman. Therefore, I am obliged to him. Though that obligation may not be continuing, but still personal level. And his senior is very close to me, was very close to me. And then, Uttapalan, they asked, I refused even last week. I said that I have no time because I am engaged in this recording and uploading. And therefore, I did not. And then, Beyond Law CLC, that is Hyderabad, I participated too. Then there no other webinars, I refused everything. Niranjana asked me because her mother is known to me for the last several years. I had to oblige. Otherwise, I would have said no. Not because I have no, I'm not inclined to address the young lawyers and young friends. I am always prepared to do it. I did it during night also in the law college. That is National University of Advanced Legal Studies. When I was a sitting judge, after my work is over, I will go to the law college and take classes from 6:30 to 8:30. I did not even charge the necessary traveling arrangements also. Everything free. And I found a pleasure. I thought that it is my duty to address young friends because what we earned, we have to share. But yes. I have decided not to attend any webinar because that eats my time. So far as other activities are concerned. So, but Niranjana, I could not deny because her mother is so close to me as a judicial officer. Therefore, I could not deny. Yes.
Thank you so much, sir.
I have this opportunity to address you all. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you so much, sir, for taking our time from your very busy schedule. I know you are busy with your own YouTube channel and app. It's an honor to attend your class and to host you, sir. Thank you so much for this opportunity that you gave us. And thank you all participants for participating. Sir, this is our fifth webinar that we are conducting as the Outspoken Narrative. And this has been a long journey for us because we started off very, fickle-minded because we didn't know if this would work. But with God's grace and with all the participants' support, we have come this far. And we are planning to go further also. So thank you so much, everyone, for participating. And thank you so much, sir, for agreeing.
Namaste.
So this was our most interactive webinar. As we have received the feedback from our participants, this was our most interactive webinar. So thank you so much, sir, for sharing the knowledge with us. Thank you so much.
At some point of time, somewhere in the world. Yes,
sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Also, before we part, I would like to point out a few things. We have started a YouTube channel called The Outspoken Narrative. So all the recording that has been taken, or webinars recording that has been happened taken till now, will be uploaded soon in it. So please subscribe to our channel so you can get an access to all the classes that have happened till now.
And also like our Facebook page and follow us on Instagram, The Outspoken Narrative. Welcome to the Outspoken Narrative family. Thank you so much, you all.
All our social media channels goes by the same name, so please do support us. So once again, thank you everyone, and we are ending the session.
Hope to see you in our coming webinars. Thank you so much. Yes.
Not next webinar, please excuse me.
Yes, sir.
I will, but if
participants demands, then sir, you have to come.
No, see, I will do it. I am doing it every day. And you listen to that. See, more than 130 episodes of half an hour each.
Yes, sir.
Available on YouTube free. And I request all of you to see that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I will share the links with everyone.
So that it is possible.
We'll share those episodes on our YouTube page also, sir.
We'll share that
people can see. Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.